next speaker. Talking about leadership in a world of emerging technologies, welcome to the stage from University of Derby, Richard J. Self. Let's give a round of applause.
Thank you. I'm recording this on a video. It'll be on my YouTube channel by Monday at the latest, possibly tomorrow if you're lucky. And also they'll be distributing the PowerPoint presentation in the notes format for you to pick up if you want to follow on some of the thoughts beneath the go with the slides. Okay. So I've been at the University of Derby now since about 2002. After 30-odd years at Rolls-Royce Aerospace in a whole range of jobs, mainly at the interface between the business world and the world of IT. Once I started at the University of Derby, I got quite interested in the question of governance. How do we do the right thing? And it actually ends up as knowing the questions that you need to ask, ladies and gentlemen, you are to get value out of all of these emerging technologies that we've been covering today. First of all, I want to look a little bit at what leadership means, because I guess almost all of you are leaders of your teams, leaders of your companies, and I want to try and put into context what that role means, so that as we develop it to look at the fundamental questions about eight emerging technologies, which I've been thinking about for quite a while, but there's a LinkedIn article, well, there's a LinkedIn posting by a guy called Bernard Marr from a Forbes article he published just last week. And it really brought into a clear focus what I need to talk about for you guys today. So, the other thing about all these emerging technologies is they are high on the Gartner hype cycle. The products which are being developed and the developers are looking for an enormous amount of money from you guys for them to develop their products into usable, or their ideas into usable products. And then I give you, at the end, six interesting W questions in English that might help you to demythologize all of these hyped technologies, these emerging technologies. But let's start at management and leadership. You see, there are fundamental differences between managing a group of people and leading a group of people. Managing is about organizing people and resources and money and stuff to get things done. It's a bit like being a shepherd round at the back, trying to round up people into where you want them to go. You see, a classic UK shepherd, a Western shepherd. However, if you go back in history, go back to biblical times, you see this picture. Leader. My sheep follow me because they know my voice. Many of you will recognize that quotation. So the first thing is to ask yourself the question, are you a manager? The worst case, herding cats without the help of a sheepdog herding sheep. Or are you a leader leading from the front, setting the tone, setting the direction? Not necessarily knowing the answers, but knowing how to form a team who do know the questions to ask the answers that will help you to gain value from your technology for your business. You see, the manager probably will tell you the question, how to do it, or what has to be done. The leader says, I want to cross a river, a manager probably will say, I want a bridge. Which are you? Now, much of what I say will sound a little bit difficult, perhaps, for many people. Because I ask questions, I am skeptical, that means I ask the question, prove it. But if I'm a cynic, I will say, I just don't believe. But I want you to ask some questions, which we will come across at the very end. You need to be skeptical about the promises of all of these emerging technologies. You do not have to be cynical, however long you have been in the industry. I've been in it now the best part of 50-odd years. I almost have the right to be cynical, but in fact, I'm still skeptical. Because there's so much stuff out there that actually could be quite interesting, quite valuable in certain circumstances. And it's finding those circumstances when it will deliver value that's your challenge as a leader, to get your teams to ask the right questions, to find the right, as they call it, use case these days, the right situation where it will, if you're careful, if you give it the right budget, if you give it the right time scale, it might well deliver the value that you need. You see, nobody or very few people have ever seen this set of data. It's been collected since 1994 by United States consultancy group called the Standish Group. And they've been collecting data about the success and failure of IT-related systems over since 1994, based on input from chief information officers around the world. For the first about 20-odd years, just under, they defined a successful project as one which was delivered on time to budget and delivered the contracted for functionality. Failures, well, that's fairly obvious. They're the ones that never went into production, never delivered anything, were cancelled. And then in between, they have the category which they call challenged. They were late, they were over budget, and only delivered part of the contracted for functionality. But chief information officers got very tetchy quite reasonably. Towards the mid, early 2000s, saying, yeah, but we're not trying to deliver functionality, we're trying to deliver value to our business, to our organization. And they thought that if they did that, they would see the percentage of successful projects increasing. So in 2013, Standish Group changed the definition, and backtracked to 2011, I think it was, yeah, to on time, to budget, and delivering business value. And they showed this lines, the two lines in the middle, the blue and the purple, show that actually some of those systems which were delivered on time to budget and delivered the functionality actually deliver business value. And the worst one was 2012, where the numbers were 39% contractual obligations, but only 27% delivered value. How many of you are even aware of those numbers, folks? Hands up, anybody who knew those data? Is it a surprise to you? It turns out that all of our new technologies, IT related, are delivering that same low level of success. If you take all of the failures of IT and the challenges, including security costs, you know, all these huge break-ins and hacking attempts we see, and the fact that when we deliver a system which doesn't deliver what the customer actually needs to do their whole job, but only part of it, they have to come up with workarounds which waste their time. We spend roughly $3-3.5 trillion US a year across the world implementing and supporting all of our ICT systems. That is something like 5-7% of world GDP. We spend something about, have a world GDP of about $75 trillion. One calculation of the costs of all of the failures to deliver value, to deliver useful systems, is $6 trillion of wasted effort and resources a year. Not far short of 8% or 9% of world GDP, just because our IT doesn't work properly. All the disconnections between different parts of our workflows. Areas of robotics, this RPA stuff, can help with, if implemented carefully. So as we look at emerging technologies, AI, machine learning, etc., 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 we need to ensure, you need to ensure, that your projects are not part of the 75% of useless projects. One thing I think from many, many years of experience, having worked in implementing systems and had one phenomenal success in 1985, 86, 87, when I led a small team of 2.5 people to build what was then probably the largest project management system in the world using SaaS on the mainframe. It did, we built it piloting, working directly with the users day by day to build each module. And it then ran almost unchanged, unmodified, unsupported. 15 years until it was decommissioned as a result of implementing SAP. Do many of you have any systems which ran unmodified, unchanged for 15 years? Our apps on our smartphones are modified every 2 to 4 weeks, aren't they? Because they weren't tested. People are just fiddling. How many of you are on LinkedIn? And how often do you notice that LinkedIn breaks or something changes? And for a day or so, it doesn't work properly, and then a couple of days later, they fixed it. LinkedIn, you've got 1,000 coders, software people, that I think down in Chennai. If you've got 1,000 people working on a system like LinkedIn, they've got to do something. So they fiddle and try and improve it. And then it breaks and then they have to fix it again. Part of the success or failure problem. Now, some years back, 2012, a guy called John Easton from IBM put up this chart, pointing out another problem that we really don't tend to recognize. I never even thought about it really while I was working in the systems field. The fact that 80% of all of the data we are using, wherever it comes from, whether it's our location data on that's captured on here, or anything else, or our master data in our ERP systems, 80% of the data is of uncertain veracity. What that means is, we don't know for certain without a deep investigation whether that data is right or wrong, or by how much it is wrong. This has huge consequences when we're trying to use much of this data in our analytics systems or our AI systems. I first started talking at these management events conferences about 4 years ago, when I came to Notes of Management Events because of some research my students had been doing about the accuracy or otherwise of the GPS locations recorded by our smart sold by the Americans had been accurate to around about plus or minus 8 or 10 meters 95% of the time, provided you can see the whole horizon, which of course most places you can't. So I got my students to take location tag photos in all sorts of realistic places, outdoors, indoors, retail areas, urban, etc., etc. And their data was 25% meters accuracy 85% of the time. The other 15% was much more interesting. The problem was that other 15% went from 25 meters, 50, 100, 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers, 1800 kilometers. And that, of course, has governance consequences of trust. If you're a retailer, you really don't want to be sending retail ads saying, oh, you've got an offer, a discount offer, or free coffee at Starbucks just around the corner from you. And you're in Helsinki, and it's putting you in a village or a town 20, 30 miles away, kilometers away from here. You think of that as spam, and it will start getting irritated. It turns out, from an analysis of billions of location target adverts in the USA in the 2016-ish, 15% of all location target adverts in the USA are pointed at places some more than 800 kilometers from where the person's phone actually was. Even with ERP systems, we cannot trust the data. You have clean data, you've thrown away 70-80% of your data before you implement your new ERP system like SAP. Within 5 years, you will have had to have implemented some fairly vigorous data cleansing exercises to keep the data accurate enough that you can trust the analysis for making your management decisions. So I wanted to look at some of the topics which are relevant today and will be affected by that veracity problem. Natural language processing, the thing that's making chatbots work, that helps us to have semi-intelligent answer phone systems that allow you to route your way through a switchboard. We're using computer vision in all sorts of interesting places. We're using robotics, both the RPAs or office automation stuff and physical robots. We've got autonomous vehicles, Tesla, Uber, Waymo. We're using AR, or augmented reality, virtual reality, extended reality. And we've got these smart assistants and chatbots. The problem is, we haven't a clue what most of these pattern matching neural network based systems are actually learning. We have a problem of data bias. The military, we're trying to teach a vision system to recognize the difference between enemy and friendly tanks. And they did it very well. Had lots of photos of both situations. And they did the thing that they were supposed to do and trained it on 80% of the photos until it was working well, then put the other 20% through to confirm that it learned the right lessons. The only trouble really was working perfectly, except for one little fact. The neural networks doing this image recognition hadn't learned anything about tanks. They didn't even recognize that there was a tank in the photo. They categorized the background. It just happened that all of the enemy tanks had one background, all of the friendly tanks had the other background, and that was what it knew. And there are many, many examples of that. Fortunately, they discovered, because this was for clever, smart munitions, and it would have been embarrassing if they managed to shoot up their own friendly tanks because they were in the wrong background. Or biased, racist, Joy Boone-Winney, that lass at the bottom there at MIT. She's got a TED talk on this. this. She was training, or trying to train, a camera to be able to say to her, "Hello, Joy," as she walked into her office. And she was using one of the standard trained face recognition systems, and there are about 5 around at the moment, all trained on the same 100,000 photos. The only problem was, because she had a dark face, a very dark face, it couldn't see that there was a face in the photo at all. Because there were only 2.5% of the photos had dark black women's faces on it. Data bias. It worked beautifully on male Caucasian faces, because they're nice and white, and it was trained on 75% of the database of photos with white male Caucasians. And there's lots of other examples of this sort of bias, and it learns. It learns the patterns in the data that we give it. Is it accurate enough? Probably not. A couple of examples of we can do it, but maybe should we? A small sample of a few hundred, if that, on the left, was able to detect within a certain ethnic group in China whether people were criminal or not criminal with 89.5% accuracy. That may seem fantastic and very good, except what happens to the 10.5% people who are misidentified as criminals? On the right hand is, are you gay or straight? And of course we know of countries who would love to have this sort of technology at immigration. Oh, sorry, Mr. Self. Our system says you are criminal of intent. You can't come in. Or, oh, you're a citizen, Mr. Self, and you're gay. Right, come along this way into this little door. To do these sort of things, or even the simple thing of entry management in a hotel. I was staying at the Crown Plaza last night. Something like 400 rooms, 800 people. If it was 99% accurate, and it's not, that means 8 people a day at least will be refused entry to their room. Face recognition has to get to about 99.59% accurate across large databases of photos if it is to be safe for everybody. Autonomous vehicles, we've been told. Well, we were told until the middle of last year that autonomous vehicles are going to be with us by end of 2020. And then on the 14th of November 2018, John Krafcik, head of Waymo, announced on Bloomberg, the day that I was in Cologne at another management event, he said, level 5, fully automated, no controls for humans, vehicles will not be available for all conditions, all circumstances, for many decades. And we already know what's happening with Tesla Autopilot. It's managed to kill about 5 people already. Because it's not ready. It's less than level 3, i.e. it needs you to have your hands on the steering wheel, your feet on the pedals at all times, concentrating on the traffic. You cannot let your attention wander. Because if you do, it will take you 3 to 30 to 40 seconds and more to regain your situational awareness, by which time it's probably curtains for you or somebody else. Level 3 is dangerous, incredibly dangerous. Level 4, we're nowhere near ready for that. Autonomous vehicles are decades away, most likely. Unless someone comes up with something spectacularly new in the way of controlling and training these things. Let's look at 3 more little items that struck me while looking at the agenda. 1, digital twins. In aerospace, we've had a level of digital twins for engine condition monitoring now since the 1960s. It developed dramatically with enhanced engine condition monitoring in the mid-1980s. Rolls-Royce, Pratt & Whitney, General Electric, all went live on the big engines for the 747. But even those digital twins that capture the mechanics, the aerothermal dynamics of the way that that machine works, so as to filter out obviously bonkers data, i.e. the sensor has failed, and then comparing the measurements against the expected situation to identify the trend long term for predictive maintenance. It works. However, as someone pointed out a few days ago, one of the things about predictive maintenance and digital twins would be magical, because he had been stuck on a cancelled flight because his seat wouldn't come back into the takeoff position. So that's a safety critical issue, flight cancelled until fixed. He would have loved to have a digital twin of that locking mechanism for seats on every seat in the aircraft. Really? Think of the expense. Think of the amount of data. Digital twins are a good idea. They provide the context for us to do our predictive maintenance analytics. We've heard huge amounts about blockchain. It will be the solution to every possible IT problem we have at the moment. Here it is, magic technology. Problems, I'm not quite sure what I'm offering a solution to. What's the problem? That chart shows you the hype of where the problems might be. And the financial services industry has spent something like $1.5 billion a year for the last 3 or 4 years trying to find a problem that blockchain will actually solve for them. It turns out several reports, including one from Mario Draghi, the head of the European Central Bank, that there is no obvious opportunity for blockchain to improve things compared to current technology, because the problems that need solving are nothing to do with technology, they are to do with process and people and working practices. The other thing to remember, folks, is blockchain is the only known IT technology which is non-scalable. Any of the problems your organizations, however large or small they are, if you need to get more transactional throughput, you increase the number of processors. You just throw servers at the problem until it's working. Blockchain doesn't work like that. Blockchain has its own internal heartbeat related to the block formation cycle. And that is independent of the number of CPUs you're throwing at it. And the fastest performing blockchain system I know of is IBM's Hyperledger Fabric. And that has a heartbeat of round about 15,000 transactions a second. Some academics have found an accelerator process that can take it up to just about 20,000 transactions a second. And it will not go faster unless you change the clock cycle faster. We can't do that now. We've got to the end of that. But Visa, MasterCard, Amex can quite comfortably and very happily with their current infrastructure, each process 25,000 transactions a second, and just about keeps the world flowing in the sense of bills and payments. Interesting question, folks. And quantum computing, it is ideal for a certain highly restricted range of problems. They are things like factoring very large primes, cracking encryption codes. Very, very good at that. And it's also quite good, very good at solving things, optimization problems like the traveling salesman problem. And it can do it very fast. The only thing is, it has to run them many, many times because it's a very inaccurate and precise because of quantum effects. So you need a quantum computer to produce 1,000 answers, and then you need a classical computer to process that to come up with the best answer. It won't, in my judgment, my experience, thinking about the fundamentals of the technology, going to have much of an effect, as far as we can tell at the moment, on things like so-called quantum AI. It doesn't feel that the mathematics, the physics, are going to do much for AI in the short term. It may do longer term, we don't know yet. It's very, very difficult to tell. But the one message is, anybody in financial services, and pretty much everybody involved with GDPR and encryption, arrest and motion, needs to start thinking about moving away from the current quantum crackable codes like RSA256. You need to be thinking about implementing one of the non-quantum crackable algorithms within the next 5 years, probably. Very, very important. All of these technologies are solutions looking for problems to solve. If you think about autonomous vehicles and taxis, the new autonomous electric aircraft taxis, if you start asking some really fundamental questions, you'll begin to see that there's an awful lot of real process and human issues that need solving before many of these technologies can deliver value for you. So, the six W's. What, how, when, who, why, where. Those are the six questions, the only six questions you need to actually ask about anything. It's implemented in this rather interesting chart of the Zachman Enterprise Architecture and the TOGAF processes that shows you how you can ask these questions to obtain valuable answers at all sorts of levels of your organization, right at the very top, the strategic level, right down to the operational level at the very bottom. You need to do what's on here. You've got to start at what is the problem we're trying to solve. Don't start with here's some technology. You start at what's the business problem. Then you look at the design you need to have, and then you start looking for technologies. You go back 30 years, 40 years to how we used to do IT solutions and system development for our projects in business.
Also, and after the break, you will continue for